Hey everyone, it's Pam, and I'm here with my monthly update video letting you know everything that I was up to in the month of April. So despite April being fairly uneventful in terms of things like being able to leave the house, it was an eventful one for me in terms of podcasts, as I was a guest on two podcasts in April. The first one I was on is called Zero Brightness, and it is a podcast about horror video games hosted by Ollie and James. I started listening to this myself a number of months ago, and after a particularly scathing episode on Alan Wake, I decided to comment on their Facebook page to defend it a little bit, and anyway, ended up sort of getting involved in the community and got invited to be on the show, and we talked about the indie horror game The Cat Lady, which is one of my favorites. I played it for the first time a few years ago and really enjoyed it, and had a good time playing through again. I think the podcast turned out really well. There was definitely some differing opinions on the game, as there tend to be on other episodes. It's a really good that way that you get sort of both sides from it, and when the hosts disagree, they are not shy about sharing their opinions on that. Have a listen to that and check out some of the other Zero Brightness episodes. One thing I particularly like about the podcast is the audio quality and the way they mix music into the podcast. It's really well done, so check out Zero Brightness. The other podcast that I was on is a fairly new podcast called Drunk Friend, and it is hosted by Alex from SNES Drunk and Travis from NES Friend. I think I was on episode 6, and it is a podcast all about video games and creating content, specifically YouTube videos, about games and what that's like. So when I went on, there was a little bit of an interview to start off with where I talked about how I got into video games, how I got into YouTube, where my channel name came from, and some of the sort of like pros and cons of being on the platform, and it's followed up by some listener questions. They've had a few other guests on the podcast so far. They've had Daria from Daria Plays RPGs and Dan from Console Wars, and sometimes it's just the two of them. So if you are into YouTube and video game YouTube, definitely go check out Drunk Friend. For my shout-out this month, I want to suggest that you check out The Girl with the Controller. This is a channel that focuses on shorter video essays. Some of them are about game design, and some of them can be about how video games can sort of be personally resonant with the players. She doesn't post videos all that often, but I'm always excited to check out the videos when she does put a new one up. The most recent one is on Borderlands 2 and how the world building gives it character. One of my favorite videos on the channel is on Uncharted 4 and how it presents conflict and growth in a marriage. And I've never even played Uncharted 4, but I still found the video very insightful and very entertaining to watch. Another one is all about Monkey Island and its particular style of humor and how that works. So the games that she looks at are very diverse. She'll go everything from older games like Monkey Island to brand new games, so there should be something for everyone. And other than the Uncharted video, which was a bit longer, most of them are only maybe like 6 to 8 minutes long, so they're short, but they're also very insightful and very well done. So check out The Girl with the Controller. So now we're on to pickups, and I thought I would have a number of pickups to show off because I ordered a few vinyl back in March, but they were all pre-orders and none of them have actually shipped yet. So I think the only thing that I actually physically picked up was Final Fantasy VII Remake. And I'm not going to talk too much about it because I am only in chapter like 8 or 9 so far. I am in the church, but it's a bit of a mixed bag. I found the first hour and a half, the first mission where you're blowing up the Mako reactor, excellent. Like, it was better than I thought it would be. I was super pumped, and then you get to the slums and they just throw a bunch of stupid, boring fetch quests at you that just like grinds the pace of the game to a halt. So yeah, a little bit mixed. It does sort of pick up after that, but I'm sure there's going to be more side quests somewhere to come so that they can stretch out the length of this game more than they need to. but I am generally enjoying it. I just think they've sort of thrown some junky stuff into it that isn't really needed, but I will let you know my thoughts on it more probably next month after I've had a chance to finish it. So as for games that I finished, I feel like I didn't finish that many games in April. I spent a ton of time playing games, but I was kind of just like jumping from game to game, just like unwilling to commit to one. I did finish Rayman, of course, and Gabriel Knight, both of which I have posted reviews of if you want to check those out. But the big game that I completed was Doom Eternal, and I talked about this a little in the last video, but I have lots of thoughts on it, probably enough thoughts to make an actual review, but I didn't record any gameplay footage at all, and I'm not really willing to play through again properly in order to get the footage, so I'll just give you my thoughts on the game here. So just to preface this all, Doom 2016 was my favorite game the year it came out. It's like in my top 20 games of all time now. And what made it so good was how fast and streamlined it was. So there was very minimal cutscenes, there was minimal downtime. You had to, and if you wanted to succeed, be extremely aggressive. If you needed more health or ammo or armor, you needed to go and find a demon and kill it and take those things from it. So there's no like cover, no reloading, no waiting for your health to regenerate. It was all very go, go, go. And I had a lot of fun with that. And I feel like in Doom Eternal, they didn't really take what made Doom 2016 and carry it forward. They sort of like messed with the formula a little, and of course you want a game to sort of evolve and add new things with new installments, but I feel like they added a little too much. Just to start out with, they added a lot of junk. Like, there's way more cutscenes in the game than there was. There's a lot of lore, and honestly, I don't care about the story in Doom. There's demons, I need to kill them, that's really all I need to know, so I felt that was all kind of wasted. Of course, you're not forced to go read the lore entries or anything, but the cutscenes you do have to watch, so that slowed things down. They also, like, just shove tutorials in your face all the time. Anytime a new enemy spawned, immediately a tutorial pops up saying, like, this is its weak spot, this is how you kill it, which seemed very strange to me. Like, I don't know why they would feel the need to tell you how to kill every single enemy, except one. There's one enemy that you start seeing sort of in the later half of the game, which will spawn waves of demons continuously until you kill it, and it also sort of hides, and for some reason that one never gets a tutorial. So when I first came across that, I was just fighting waves and waves and waves of demons before I even realized that that's what was happening there. So it's strange that that was the one thing that didn't include it. The pace of the game is also a little off, and I found the beginning and the end of the game were the weakest, whereas the middle was the most fun part. Just so I'm not being entirely negative here, because it's my opinion isn't entirely negative, it's still very fun. Like, the combat can be very, very satisfying. The different abilities are good. The weapons all feel different and they're fun to use. It's still very sort of like fast and frantic, and there's demons coming at you, and the glory kills are fantastic, and even the platforming, though I didn't like it at the beginning of the game, starts to really like add to the levels and things. But they just throw a lot at you at the very beginning of the game. Basically, all of the abilities that you had in Doom 2016, you get again within the first two or three levels, and it's kind of a lot. By the end of things, you have so many special abilities to use in combat. You have a blood punch, which can give you health back. You have a flame attack, which can set demons on fire and give you armor. You've got your chainsaw, which is an instant kill, which will give you a lot of ammo back. You've got this crucible, like lightsaber thing, which is also an instant kill and will give you a bunch of health back. You've got grenades. You can change between frost grenade to freeze things or like regular frag grenades. And a lot of these things require some kind of ammo or some kind of item in order to be able to use them, or they have a cooldown or some way of charging them up during the fight. And everything happens so fast that I feel like you really need to be strategic with how you're using each of these items in order to like get your ammo back and get your health back and like stay at a safe level. But there's not really much time to do a lot of strategizing. So I often felt like the combat was happening so fast and I was paying so much attention to where I was going and not like falling off a ledge or getting killed by a demon that I didn't even have time to like flick my eyes down to the corner of the screen to see if something was off cooldown or if I had ammo for it. I would just try to use it, and if it didn't work, I would go on to the next thing. So it was just really a lot, especially at the beginning of the game. I did get used to it sort of around the middle, and I did start enjoying it much more then. One of the things where it is an improvement over Doom 2016 is the level design and just like the aesthetic of the game. The levels are absolutely beautiful in this game, both like the skyboxes and the backgrounds around you. They're all really, really nice. The sort of set design, that's not what it's called, but like the design of everything is just really cool. Like there's all these big like Titan demons in the background, sort of dead. Sometimes you're even like climbing up them to get to like the next place you're going, and it just looks beautiful. The levels are much more memorable than they were in Doom 2016, where things sort of started feeling a little samey by the end of the game. Here, just like every level really stands out, and I really like that part of it. There is a fair bit of platforming in the game, and it was awful during the first few levels. I felt it didn't control particularly well, and I just don't like first-person platforming. You do get a skill later on in the game that makes it easier to control yourself while you're in the air, and I did eventually find that the platform did actually add to things. It sort of broke things up a little bit from the regular combat. One thing that I really didn't like was this new enemy type called the Marauder, and it just ran contrary to the rest of the game design. It's again a very like aggressive game where it's just like go, 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 never stop shooting, whereas the Marauder, you could only attack it as like a counterattack. Its eyes would flash green, and that's when you had to attack it. And if you attacked it at any other time, it would either like spawn a dog to come and attack you, or something else bad would happen. If you got too close, it would shoot you with its shotgun. If you got too far away, it would hit you with a ranged attack. It was just a very, very annoying enemy, and it often came with a ton of other demons as well. And even when I got to the point where I was killing it on my first try every time, I still just didn't feel it added anything to the game. I actually felt like it took away from my enjoyment of the game. There are also some boss fights, which are so-so. I found most of the boss fights were okay, though they kind of just seemed like glorified regular demon fights, since you were still having other waves of demons spawning throughout the whole thing. There was definitely nothing as good as the Cyber Demon from Doom 2016. Oh, and you get a space castle, which is kind of cool, I guess, but also a little bit weird. So yeah, that's what I thought about Doom Eternal. I did have a lot of fun with it, especially in those sort of middle levels of the game, and it was cool to like upgrade your various abilities. Again, the combat is still a lot of fun, even though it can sometimes be overwhelming. I did like the new abilities that they added, and the guns still feel a lot of fun to play with, but they just added too much extra stuff, too many like tutorials popping up and lore and cutscenes and things that I don't really think added much to the game. But overall, fun, just not as good as the previous one. So the other game that I played and finished is Journey to the Savage Planet, which I played on Xbox. It just came on Game Pass. And from what others have told me, because I've never played this game myself, but it's apparently a lot like Metroid Prime, so a Metroidvania, but a first-person kind of world. And it's about you're like a nameless astronaut, you're like a colonizer of a planet sent by this big faceless corporation to go and do their bidding, and little story bits are dropped here and there where you're like very much in debt, and this is sort of the only avenue open to you. While I was playing it, I just kept thinking about The Outer Worlds. Very similar vibe, although much more fun gameplay. You sort of, just like any Metroidvania, you sort of open up new abilities as you go, and that lets you get to new places on this planet. There is like a scanning mechanic where you scan all of the wildlife and animals in order to sort of level yourself up and get experience. And you're looking for this sort of life source that you've found on the planet that your sort of overlords want you to go and investigate. So my feelings on this are kind of strange because, as I said, I don't really like first-person platforming, and there's a ton of that in this, and I don't even really like how the combat played, but somehow I still had a lot of fun and sort of zipped through the game in just a few days. I think it was about it being sort of very mission-based and like giving you your different tasks combined with exploring this planet and finding like beautiful new environments and cool new creatures that are maybe trying to kill you if you show any aggression towards them. And so I overall had a pretty good time with it. There's some crafting and things like gathering resources and crafting. And when you go back to your ship, there are ads playing that are all done in FMV with real actors, which of course I always like. And it just has a very like funny, silly tone to it to add to like the actual gameplay. So yeah, Journey to the Savage Planet, even though that is definitely a questionable title, was overall pretty fun. So other than those, I've just been playing a ton of XCOM. I've been playing XCOM Enemy Within, just sort of plugging my way through a playthrough. I've been playing it on classic difficulty for a bit of an extra challenge, and that's going pretty well so far. And then, sort of out of nowhere, a new XCOM came out. It's called Chimera Squad, which is a bit more like story and character based, but still has sort of similar tactical combat. I'm not too far into that. I've only played about an hour or so, so I'll probably have more thoughts on that for next month. So that is everything that I have to share for April. Please don't forget to check out Zero Brightness and Drunk Friend and The Girl with the Controller. Leave me a comment if you want to share any interesting games that you've played over the last little while or pickups you've gotten. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.